Okay, my topic is change and innovation opportunities, and it goes as follows. If you read economic textbooks, then you find very often the phrase innovations as drivers of economic growth and economic welfare. You find us all in these economic textbooks. And if you look into economic reality, then of course we see marvelous riches which were created, marvelous advances in technology which were created over the last decades and centuries. So there seems to be something in it. The question is, who are the ones who are able to exploit innovation opportunities? And secondly, related to that, and at whose social costs? Joseph Alois Schumpeter, maybe the father of the economics of innovation, he gave already answers to these two questions. First, he said, not everybody launches innovations, but only a relatively small group. Not everybody is able to do this. It's a relatively small group of actors who do that. Out of this group, maybe only the blue one. These actors may be entrepreneurs, that means that are people who found a new firm based on the new idea. But on the other hand, of course, large innovative firms are also driver of this process, like the firm of Zeiss here in Jena. What that implies is that if you look at the population of actors, you have innovators on the one hand and you have non-innovators on the other hand. You have to distinguish those. So it's only a smaller group of actors who really are engaged in these innovation activities. There are welfare effects, of course, because what do these entrepreneurs or large firms do? They create better or less costly products and services which can be used and consumed by the customers, and when we buy these products, then we benefit from that. So welfare effects are there, and this is the positive side of innovation activities. However, Schumpeter made another statement. Related to these innovation activities, there is structural change. And this process of structural change, he coined the notion of creative destruction. Creative, doing something new, but just by doing that, you have a destructive effect, something is destroyed. New concepts, new technologies replace old ones. Here is, for example, digital photography conquering analog photography, and the firm of Kodak is a very prominent example, a firm which was not able to manage this change. There a new technology came in and Kodak wasn't able to take it up and to develop it, and they suffered very much from this new concept. So new concepts replace old ones. If we now look at the welfare effects, which on the slide before were so much positive, better products, less costly products, everything is well for our welfare, then of course these welfare effects appear being ambiguous. Because that means those who do the new things, they may have welfare effects, but those who get destroyed by these new concepts, they suffer from that. So it might be a little bit exaggerated here, a welfare effect, a positive welfare effect, which is necessarily accompanied by an effect into poverty. So some are negatively affected by these activities. Now, one may have the argument that if innovation activities would be totally random, that in each period, each one of us has the same probability to run a new product or to run a new process, then it doesn't matter, because at one point you are successful and I am negatively affected by that. In the next period of time, I'm successful, you are negatively affected. Over time, who cares? Everybody is positive and negatively affected. However, this random process does not work that way. Because we have a process where past dependency and virtuous and vicious circles are involved. How does this, in a nutshell, work? Innovation or the innovative capabilities, the ability to run new things, to create new things, they develop in an unequal way. This has to do with the fact that knowledge and competences, which are required to run successfully innovations, that they develop in a cumulative way. This is a shortcut for the process that which says, what you can create of new knowledge today depends on the amount of knowledge you have accumulated until today. And if you have two actors, one has lower knowledge and the other has more knowledge, then the likelihood that one with more knowledge will create new knowledge is much higher than the likelihood for that one who has lower knowledge. So the cumulative process which is taking place. Now, this cumulative process leads to gaps in knowledge or in technology or in competences in the following way. Here's a graph where you have on the x-axis the time and on the y-axis you have knowledge and competences. And here we have a certain actor B who starts accumulating knowledge over time. This convex curve is just his cumulative effect. If you have now an actor A, which in starting point zero has a little bit of an advantage, a little bit higher knowledge, and he also is accumulating knowledge cumulatively over time, then you see it's also an increasing function, the blue function, but the absolute distance between the two is increasing over time. In the beginning it's relatively low, but then the distance is becoming larger and larger. These are these gaps, which I mentioned at the top of the slide. And these gaps lead that one is more successful, the other is less successful. Maybe the lower one, the B one, has to give up at a certain point in time. Now you may argue, okay, knowledge can spill over, you can learn from the others. Okay, if you assume that, then B is a little bit higher, this curve, because he can imitate a little bit what A is doing. But usually imitation is not perfect, though there is not a complete catch-up from B to A. And then secondly, if you take into account that A has better competences, therefore has better market results than B, then A will be able to invest more and more compared to B into generating new knowledge, and this would lead an even higher cumulative curve for A. So markets may reinforce this process. In a nutshell, we have actors which develop differently, and the gap between the two when they accumulate knowledge becomes larger and larger over time. And this, as we will see, has detrimental effects on the economic realm. We call this dynamic increasing returns to scale, this phenomenon, and I think it's something which characterizes the complete scene of technology and innovation development. Now, what are the economic effects? Let's first go to industrial dynamics. Higher knowledge and competences lead to higher market success and higher survival rates. Survival rates means how long can you stay in a market? How long can you operatively be successful in the market? Because if your performance is very weak, at a certain point in time, you may be forced to exit the market. We started this for the German automobile industry from 1886 to 1939. 1886 is the birthday, by the way, of the automobile industry, because there are two firms were founded by Daimler and by Benz independently. And we look now at a large number of firms which compete in this automobile industry. Some of these firms have a very high experience. Others have a very low experience, and then there are two groups in between. Now, if you look now at this slide here, you see first the survival curve for those firms with very low experience. This green negatively sloped line tells you how many of 100% of those firms will be still in the market after a certain point in time. The red horizontal line is the 50% line. That means at that point, 50% of all firms are still in the market. The other 50% had already to exit. And if you look carefully at that, then you see that for those low performer, after 2 years, 50% of them had to exit the market, relatively fast. We have another group which have a little bit more experience, a little bit more knowledge. If you look at their survival curve, then you see here, the survival curve is higher, and it has a four-year duration that until 50% of the firms are not in the market anymore. Then you have relatively highly competent firms, there the duration to be that 50% have had to exit is 5 years. And then we have the top performers, which have really high experience in this market. And for them, for this group, after only 9 years, 50% of them had to exit the market. You see so now that depending on the knowledge and competence level these firms have, the likelihood to have to exit from the market is the higher the lower is your competence and knowledge you accumulated over time. So we have winners and losers. The losers are those which had to exit. And for those who are less educated, they have to exit earlier. Second example, cluster and industrial districts. Usually these innovation activities take place in geographical spaces. And in these spaces, these actors collaborate and exchange ideas. And by this, the competence and knowledge level of these regions is increasing over time. Then this leads to a certain type of clustering. And if you look at this clustering of innovative activities for Europe, then you find here on a regional level, very fine-grained here, different colors. And the colors tell you how many patents per 1 million inhabitants you have. And the darker the color, the darker the red, let's say, the more patents per million inhabitants you have. This is an indicator how good is the performance of the respective region in creating new ideas. And you see, this is not evenly distributed. It is relatively heterogeneous. Of course, you have some high spots here in southern Germany, for example, or in Switzerland, but also other areas where you have a relative low intensity. If you would track that over time, it would not change very much over time. So this is a relative persistent pattern. And you find, of course, even within Germany, a relatively unequal development over time. Some very prosperous, innovative regions compared to others which are not that prosperous. Third example, world income distribution. Now we go on the country level, from the firm over the region to the country level. What you find here is that globally we have a very unequal development of per capita income, if you accept this as an indicator for welfare. I know it's a wrong indicator, but it's easy to calculate. And there we have the phenomenon of so-called twin peaks. What is shown here? Here it is shown the per capita income of all countries in various years with respect to the US. The US is the income leader, and then with respect to US, you have this relative income per capita, which means that you have here very low-performing countries and you have here very high-performing countries. Now, if you look in 1960, how the income per capita is distributed over the world, then you find, not surprisingly, here a peak, and here some density where some of the richer countries are located. And now, if you track that over time in 10-year steps, from 1960 to 1970, then you see that a second peak tends to emerge, 1980, 1990. So you have a twin peak structure. You have two peaks in this density distribution, and that means you have a club of very rich countries and a larger club of relatively poor countries, and the way from the poor to the rich countries is relatively difficult, because it's relatively difficult to take your way from here to here to these peaks. So income, per capita income, developed over time globally in a very, very unequal way, club of rich firms, rich countries and a club of very poor countries. Now these three results are a little bit astonishing, maybe. Innovation is always something positive, but you have losers in this process. Now, is it something which will be there forever, or are there opportunities to change the picture? Yes, there are opportunities. Because usually these grand innovation opportunities become exploited. And when they become exploited, then you have a certain upper level of competences and knowledge that you can reach. More you cannot reach because there's no opportunity to use that anymore. And then the cumulative path of knowledge development, for example, for the blue firm before, Actor A before, which was very successful, of course it's increasing, but then it's slowing down because there is nothing technologically to be developed further on. The opportunities are exploited. And for B, that means if he can survive over time, B will be able to catch up. So then at some point in time, they are on equal terms in this technology. What happens here? There is a risk of a so-called lock-in, because these actors have now a high degree of knowledge and competences in this old technology. They are bound to that, and for them it is very, very difficult to get out of this old technology to run into a new technology. If you accept this lock-in effect, then new opportunities come up, and then the question is, who is the one who can exploit these new opportunities which can come up? So you have here the old technology exploited. The actors now don't know where to go to because the old technology is not suitable anymore for progressing, so they don't know where to go to. And therefore, there are new windows of opportunities, and the race starts right from the beginning. Everybody, each actor, each region, each country, has a chance now to be the first one, and not the last one, in a new knowledge race, a new race to exploit certain technological opportunities. So there's a new game, and this rather equal chances for all participants, for all those who are engaged in that. There are examples for that. For example, in the second long wave of industrial evolution, after the industrial revolution took place in the UK, in England, the second wave was dominated by the US. So the UK lost competences to be technology leader. In the second wave, the US took over. And in the third wave, which was more chemical-based, the Germans took over, were market and world technology leader. And in the fifth long wave, which is now the IT wave, which we are still in, maybe at the end, there Japan took the lead. So there are always chances that those actors which were not so successful in the previous technology then become the most successful actors in the next generation of technologies. Certainly, for example, also on the regional level, Silicon Valley, which was before the IT was developed, was a desert, there was nothing. Out of nothing, something new can create an actor which was really not at the technology frontier before IT came up, now with IT could take the lead and developed in a, as we all know, very successful way. Or if you go more locally, in the photovoltaic industries, then you have firms like Qcells, which were founded a couple of years ago, out of the nothing. There was no one who was before that firm here and did technologies in this sense. So new chances for actors which in the previous technology had not so much success or were even not active. In this sense, there is some hope. Even if some technology developments lead really to negative effects for some economic actors, there is some hope that new windows of opportunity come up, and then the chances become more equal as they were before. Of course, this topic has more dimensions, and for example, the policy dimension would be very interesting here, but this is the topic of the talk in 2 or 3 years. Thank you very much.